We know that radical cystectomy, as clinicians, when we do, it has got a lot of morbidity. We are afraid of that. We know that we have the patients have suffered, and sometimes we think really we should do it with especially intracorporeal technique. And the morbidity varies from 25% to 65%, and mortality has come down to 1.5% to 3%, even in high volume centers. We know that this is of elderly people, so we can expect that some complications do happen. And when we plan, at least we can decrease this morbidity as well as mortality. At least the accepted mortality should be between 1 to 1.5%, and the morbidity should be around 15 to 20%. Numerous complications can happen after cystectomy. It's very difficult to, you know, make a list out of them, so the minor and major. So we can convert them into Clavien 1, 2, 3. And starting from into the most dread complication, what we think of is we always don't want our patient to suffer is intestinal obstruction, intestinal leaks, urinary leaks, and septicemia. So these are the few things which we always think. And if you take minor corrections or minor measures during or before surgery, of course we can decrease at least the incidence of these complications. So identify preoperative factors, intraoperative factors, as well as postoperative factors. So if all of us know how to do that, many times it is our just, you know, as the things go on, we forget few things, and we should be a little careful when we plan this radical cystectomy. Preoperative factors, you identify them and think what to do. Medical conditions, we know that these are elderly people with heart conditions and, you know, ischemic heart diseases, stroke and whatever, etc. Optimize them before taking. So the one of the major mistakes is to not to optimize and go in a hurry and remove the bladder. So it is going to have a dire consequences. Mechanical bowel preparation, of course, it's universal now. No mechanical bowel preparation. So we don't do at all. So we just keep the patient a liquid diet a day before. That's all. So high calorie liquid diet a day before. We don't do any mechanical bowel preparation, no enema, nothing. Thromboembolism. Of course, low molecular weight heparin. I don't know, people have different way of reducing the thromboembolic episodes. We do postoperatively. We don't give preoperatively or intraoperatively. We start from the same day evening or next day if it is a prolonged surgery. Of course, during the surgery, we have pneumatic compression, which is compulsory according to our hospital protocol. Then we have antimicrobial prophylaxis standard during induction and every 4 to 6 hours, depending upon what we use. We do use cephalosporins. Nutrition is the most important because the patients are nutritionally depleted preoperatively, and we can make a significant improvement by following enhanced recovery protocol, which is coming up in a rapid way. Now we are following this. Of course, we don't have all the medicine which they use in Western countries, but we do advise the patient to have a very high rich, high carbohydrate diet for a couple of days before. And we have early removal of the Ryle's tube and making the patient to have oral feeds. We are following almost not 100% what is given, at least to the tune of 70 to 80%. This is going to improve, and it reduces the incidence of having total parental nutrition. So patient education is very, very important. They have to know what exactly we are doing it. Especially in robotic surgery, it's a prolonged surgery. It may vary from 5 hours to 7 hours if it is a neobladder. And the patients are going to get some amount of trauma because of their position. So positioning is very important to avoid any consequences. The people have reported compartment syndromes, and people have reported gangrene of the toes. So many things can happen because of this. So utmost care, every patient has to be looked after, and the assistant plays a very important role here. And then anastomosis, definitely surgical technique. You should have a very good ureteric anastomosis, intestinal anastomosis. Fluid management is very important. So we have advised our anesthetist to have decreased fluid during the initial part of the surgery so that, you know, patient is low volume so that there is no much venous bleeding. But now with the robotic technology, so we don't bother about the bleeding because it doesn't happen much when compared to open surgery. So for an anesthetist, it is a challenge to have a steep head low position for 7 hours. So we do some modifications. There are so many anesthesia issues: sternal position, pneumoperitoneum, fluid management, upper body edema, and cardiopulmonary compromise, pneumothorax, venous air embolism, hypothermia is more important. So all these things has to be taken care individually. We can't miss any any point in this list. But what we do in cystectomy say takes 1.5 hours. And the lymph node dissection take 1 hour. That's for me. People do it faster than this. So after 2.5 hours, the tunnel bug position is completely, the patient is flat, or we give 13 degree, like what we do it in open surgery. So the anesthetist will be very happy with that. So this is how we decrease the complication, because the intestine doesn't go towards the head end when we do anastomosis. So it is very easy to do ileal conduit when you decrease the tunnel position. That is a very technical point. We redock, undock and redock, doesn't matter. It takes 5 to 10 minutes, so it will be very useful for the patient. So post-operative, of course, so we have to have early mobilization. Our patients are mobilized out of the bed next day. No matter what happens, the patient will be out of the bed. That is going to decrease our majority of our complication, chest complications. Nasogastric tube, I'm a little bit more conservative in that. So I usually keep for 48 hours or 72 hours. People remove on the second day. Simple, you know, that's okay with that. Enteral nutrition, we usually start on water on the next day. And slowly we, in 48 to 70 hours, we put it on the patient a full liquid, high calorie diet. But in patients who are unable to do this because of various reasons, then we use judiciously the TPN, so which is going to make our the morbidity list less. So again, post-operative prolonged ileus, we use prokinetics, regular analgesia, but albumepin, but I don't know, it is not available in India, I feel, and we are not using it. And even we have started using chewing gums, which is going to be prokinetic, and it increases the intestinal mobility. So one thing we have to all of us remember, I have not gone into detail because of the time, enhanced recovery protocol is the one, if all of us follow, even in open surgery or robotic surgery, it is going to make our life comfortable. There are no complications. There is nothing like we have to wait for 72 hours, 3 days, 4 days for the patient to pass motion and then start. No, we can do it early. So when we compare to open, is there any difference between the robotic and open? So there are many series, small series, and even if we have an international robotic consortium, so even that the data says that the blood loss is very less in, so that morbidity due to blood loss is very less in robotic surgery, and you can have operating time. Initially, it will be more than open surgery. Don't think about the time in the initial part. You can convert into an open or extracorporeal diversion, but we can go ahead. So we have done now in our hospital in last 4 years, 102 cases of cystectomy. Our mortality is 30-day mortality is 2. If you take 90-day mortality, it becomes 4. Intraoperative vascular injury, I had 1. So that is the technique-related morbidity to the patient. We have to convert it to the injury to the iliac artery. Clavien 2, 23. Clavien 3, 12. I think it is almost a percentage because in 100 cases. And re-exploration, we did 3 cases because of intestinal obstruction. 2, we could find out the reason. Third one, there was nothing inside. So it was a negative exploration. So even this is a very high number of morbidity. So can we? So when we compared our own series in open surgery earlier, what I used to do, these complications are much less when compared to this. We have producing a paper on this now after completing 100 cases. So thank you very much. So morbidity is common following radical. We have to accept it, but careful attention before and during and after surgery will help to reduce the risk. Thank you very much.